Good morning.
Good morning.
You notice I started my nose shave November early. That's coming up. Glad for the cooler temperature. I don't know about y'all, but I like the cold weather.
Amen.
Yes.
Us larger folks like myself really like this kind of weather. We hate sweating. This morning we're going to be in Matthew chapter 6, verse 25 to 34, talking about do not be anxious. Do not be worried. Do not be proud. Do not be scared. And so, what are the things that we're anxious about? I mean, I know that in my past, in our past, and early on in marriage, and all those kinds of things is, are we going to make rent this month? Are we going to have enough food to eat this week? Are we going to have enough money to pay the bills? Are we going to have enough money to pay the car notes? Are we going to have enough money to put gas in the car to get to work? And it's always seen sometimes there's too much month at the end of the month. And so, what are the things that we're worried about and that we're anxious about and that we go seeking after to try to remedy, that we go out and try to take over and take care of? You know, what are the worries of today? What are we preoccupied with that distract our minds and distract us away from the promises that God has given us? Or am I the only one that has anxieties? Or are you hearing me this morning?
Amen.
Have you ever been so scared, worried, or anxious that it froze you? That whatever it was that hit you, you couldn't move. And you were just frozen. And you didn't even know how to act or react. It just hit you. And you got to keep moving. You got to keep going. And we must remember that God has promised to take care of us. Now, here's something that's very interesting about God's promises. Now, God's love for us is unconditional. God's promises are conditional. He says, if you do this, I will do this. We need to hang on to that and understand that, there needs to be something from me. God does ask from us. The question is, what does he ask? We're going to get into that this morning. Is our focus on earthly things, or is our focus on the heavenly things? What preoccupies our mind? Matthew chapter 6, starting in verse 25, it says, therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more valuable than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his lifespan? Why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you? Oh, you of little faith. Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows you need them. He knows you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Now, the first part of this scripture says, Do not be anxious about your life, comma. We'll stop there. Be anxious about your life. I mean, I think my life's pretty important, don't you? Is your life important? But he says, do not be anxious about your life. What you will eat or what you will drink. Worry about your body is what you will provide. Now, we need to understand that food and water is essential for survival, right? If you don't have food and you don't have water, you're not going to live very long. Why do we need food and water? It gives us strength. Strength to do what? Work. Think. Be active. How many of y'all have ever been to school and you happened to skip breakfast that morning and you had a test? Did you think very clearly that day? Or you've gone to work and it's a strenuous job and you didn't eat and the blood sugar drops? But you know you need food, right? We know we need the food and water. And the reason we need food and water is also because it helps us stay healthy. Okay, so we know we need these things. And we got to understand, Jesus is talking to the people here, that food and water was a daily thing. You know, it's kind of hard for us to sometimes understand because we can go home for the majority of us and open up our refrigerators and we have food in there. But we're talking about in a time where they had to preserve everything that they had, or they had to consume it right then, or it was going to spoil. So, getting food and water was a daily thing. So it was very heavy on your mind. You know, you had to work, you got paid at the end of the day. When you got paid at the end of the day, you went to the market, you got the food, and you took it home and you prepared it. That's how it worked. But you had to be careful. What he's saying here is, don't be anxious about those things. In other words, don't have a soul on the forefront of your mind. That's all you have. That's all you worry about. When am I going to get the next meal? When am I going to get the next? Where's your mind? Where are you preoccupied in clothing? It says here, don't be anxious about the clothing. Well, what's the importance of clothes? Well, think about the environment that they're in. They have to be protected from the elements. That's what clothes do. They protect you from the elements. It's not how good you look in your clothes. Are you wearing the Armani suit? Are you wearing the polo shirt? Are you wearing the whatever it is? Clothes have a function. They are to protect you from the elements. They are also to aid you in the work that you're doing. You know, when I was a land surveyor, I wore certain types of clothing because it helped me do my job. When I was an armed officer at Harding University, there were certain things I had on me that helped me do my job. They can keep us cool when it's warm outside. Clothes can keep us warm when it's cold outside. They protect us from the elements. And he says, he gives this very interesting thing. He tells, look at the birds. And look at what they do and look at what they don't do. Look at the text. He says, look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? He's telling them, the birds don't farm. The birds don't store for themselves as far as putting stuff in barns, that they have a surplus of things. But they go about the things that they're supposed to go about because God's providing for them. They go out and they feed on the things that God has given them. They're trusting in the boundaries of which God has set. They're trusting that God has it for them already. And then he gives them this statement, I take care of the birds. I'm going to take care of you. Aren't you much more valuable than they? Now, birds have a very important part in our ecosystem. Everything, even those mosquitoes that we loathe, have an importance in the ecosystem. And we know that. We don't like some of those things, but they have an importance because certain animals feed on them. And then that, you know, how that changes, you know, how it just all progresses with the ecosystem. But what is so important about this claim that aren't you much more valuable than the birds? So here's the question, church. Why are we more valuable than birds? It's because we're made in God's image. We have a soul. We have certain characteristics that are godly and godlike. Now, we may not act upon them, we may suppress them, or we may even abandon them, but all people are created in God's image. Jesus has left the splendor of heaven. He is now with the people, and He's walking with the people for this reason. That's why they're important. Jesus said, I didn't come to be served, I came to serve. And I came to seek and save that which was lost.
Amen.
That's what He's telling them. That's why you're so valuable. That's why you're so... God's saying, that's why you're important to me. And because you're important to me, I'm going to take care of you. Be anxious. Being anxious is not beneficial to our health. The text here says, if you're so anxious, how many of you can be anxious and it adds to your life? It's actually the opposite, isn't it? I mean, we have terms that we use all the time. Oh, she's such a worry wart. You know, there's some truth in some of these statements. Here's one. Worry, you're going to worry yourself sick. Now, every one of us have been guilty of this, have we not?
Amen.
We've been so consumed with something, taking our eyes off of Christ, so consumed about what we're going to do next, how I'm going to fix this problem, that you've been so worried that you literally made yourself sick. Now you have to go to the doctor. Now you've missed work. And you've done things that's taken yourself out of the situation that when you needed to be in the situation. Does that make sense what I'm saying? Because you've worried yourself sick. And there's truth in that statement. There's also the truth in the statement, you worry yourself to death. Well, if I'm so worried about something, I can't add to it. But I know if I worry about something so much that it's going to take away from life. And church, there's truth in worrying yourself to death. You can worry about something so much, it can literally kill you. And he says, look at the nature. Look at the lilies of the field. And how beautifully arrayed they are. I mean, lilies in a field is a beautiful thing to see when it's swaying. I mean, think about us here. What we love to go see in the spring in this part of the country?
The blue bonnets
and the Indian paintbrushes. As long as we get the rain and the weather's right, man. When you look out across a meadow in the hill country with the cacti and the mesquite in the background with some live scrub oaks, and that field is painted with those blue bonnets and painted with those Indian paintbrushes, that's beautiful. It is beautiful. How long does it last? It doesn't last very long, does it? I mean, we have festivals about the blue bonnets. But he says here, the plants don't even toil. They don't work. They don't do anything. They're taking up after a certain period of time and thrown into the oven. You know what he's telling them here? That while those flowers are beautiful, they're also a source of heat for you. You pull them up, you wrap them up, you twist them in such a way that you put them in an oven, and it helps create heat so you can cook, so you can keep yourselves warm. And he says Solomon and all of his riches and clothing, he wasn't anywhere near as beautiful as these things are. But he says it again here. Look at Verse 30 says, "But if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will He not much more clothe you, O you of little faith?" Now we're getting to this point about this anxiousness and how to deal with it. And he says, "Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, 'What shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear?' For the Gentiles seek after these things, and our Heavenly Father knows that you need them all." He's saying here, God will take care of you. The question is, do you believe it? Do you have the faith in God when He says, "When you're mine, I will take care of you"? Now, this is where you put your faith into practice. This is where the rubber meets the road. So when the trials and the tribulations of life come at us, do we have the faith that if we keep our eyes on Christ, that He's going to lead us through it? That He's going to see us to the other side? Do we believe that or not? Christians should not be chasing the things that non-believers chase after. We don't chase after wholeheartedly about the next promotion or what kind of vehicle we're going to drive or upgrading all of these things. What about being content with what we're given? I don't know about you. I don't buy anything unless it's on the clearance rack. I like to shop at Goodwill. I like to shop at the consignments. I don't like paying full retail for anything. I'm just not going to do it. We know food and water is important. And we know that having clothes is important. We know that having shelter is important. These are necessities of life to survive, are they not? But here's the question. Are those things your treasure? That's the point we're getting at. But these things should not be our treasure. Why? Because they'll pass away. That car that you really like so well, that you paid so much money for, is going to one day break down. And you're also going to lose value. I'm preaching to the choir. You know the second you drive it off the lot, you've lost money. Because now it's a used vehicle. Here's something about money in the bank, clothes on our back, food in our refrigerators, a roof over our head. They are a false security. Because they can be taken away from you that fast. We could probably sit around and come up with about 100 different ways and situations where that can be taken away. Just ask the folks on the coast how fast things can be taken away. Ask the people who are in the Northwest how fast things can get burned up. Ask people on Wall Street how fast things can disappear in October of 1929. How fast the things that we put our faith in, which is false, can be taken away. He's pointing back to the treasure in heaven. When he said earlier, "Lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth can destroy, or rust can destroy, or thieves can break in and steal. Lay up for yourselves those treasures." Be content with what you have. Be thankful for what you have. And sometimes in the situation that we're in, we need to be thankful. And sometimes the situation we're in, churches, we don't like sometimes the situation we're in, because sometimes we're in a dogfight of trying to just make it to the end of the month. Sometimes we get hit with illnesses and diseases and cancers, and we get hit with all kinds of things, and we don't know what we're going to do next. But where is the goal? Where is the value? Where is the treasure that we're going to lay up for ourselves? Our treasure is supposed to be in heaven. So no matter world what you can bring to me, no matter world what you can hit me with, you cannot destroy me. You cannot kill me. You may take this flesh and blood from me, But my treasure's in heaven. You want to go ahead and knock me out of this race in this world? Fine, I get to go to my reward. Because Romans tells us we've been made more than conquerors. That's overwhelmingly conquerors. And as long as I keep the main thing, that is focus my eyes on Christ and being in right relationship with God the Father, nothing can separate me from that. As long as I keep myself there. Don't go chasing off after things that have no merit. Because he says, now, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. Seek the place of abode. Seek the place of attitude. Do you get that? Seek the place of abode. That's the family. That's here. And that's also heaven. And then seek the place of attitude. The righteousness of God. The characteristics of God. And put those things on. Because that is where the cure of anxiousness is. You put to death being anxious by being faithful in Christ. And giving it to Christ. Because his kingdom will never fade or be destroyed. The kingdom here on earth is the church and its Christians. And our final destination is heaven. Now, there is a legitimate concern for our future. Christ isn't talking about being concerned about the legitimate things. There are things that we need to discuss and talk about and do. But we're talking about things that so consume you that it takes your mind and your focus off of Christ. Jesus was teaching about the mindless fretting that saps our energy and renders us less capable of meeting future challenges. God has given us what we need to take care of ourselves and others. The question is, are we being good stewards of those things? Including our time. We must be faithful. And we should place our worries, our anxieties, and fears in God's hands. And when we do that, let him deal with it. If you want to know what it's like to lay your anxieties and fears down, you want to lay those burdens down, but you don't know Christ, there are several of us here that will help you introduce you to Christ. Putting on Christ in baptism. Being added to the church. Having the indwelling of the Holy Spirit with you. That's going to help you with those things. If you've wandered away, and you've fallen away, and you want to restore and have a restoration, because you're tired of all the anxieties and the worries in life, and you want to put that faith and that hope back into Christ, back into God the Father, let us assist you. Whatever need you have this morning, let us help you in any way we can. As we stand, as we stand.